We've done a couple artists on this show now where we link the music of an artist back to their image. I think it's crucial to look at the bigger picture when analyzing a musician, because understanding where someone is coming from will often give you important clues about their reasoning behind certain musical choices. We're going to do some deep digging in this episode as well, but let's see if we're on the same page first. In your own words, how would you describe Drake? What stands out about him as a person and as an artist? Pause the video now to make up your own list and come back to see if we agree. Now, what have you come up with? Here's a few of mine. He's a ladies' man. He's very sexy. He's real and honest. His music is very chill, what you might call music for the road. He's a black Jew from Toronto. And there's this contrast of this emotional, vulnerable type versus a confident winner type. We're gonna go through each one of these in some shape or form in this video to see how these character traits reflect in Drake's music and marketing. Now in film editing, there's a phenomenon known as the Kuleshov effect. A test group is shown a man looking straight into the camera, intercut with different pictures for each group. A bowl of soup,
a beautiful woman,
a child in a coffin. What's interesting is that after this experiment, all of the participants could see the corresponding emotion in the actor's face. Indifference, happiness, and sadness, even though the footage of the actor was the same in all three groups. The actors simply acted neutral. This is a technique we still see in movies today, as in Drive, where we, the viewers, bring the emotions to the characters. There is a similar effect in music, which I've previously talked about in the Taylor Swift video. Basically, the less you say, the more you're saying. You remember, Andrew Stanton calls it the unifying principle of 2+2. Drake does this a lot too, where he'll leave you to figure out most of the music for him. And I think ultimately, that's what makes him come across as sexy. What does Drake do to sound sexy? What does it mean to have sex appeal in the first place? And how is it different from being sensitive or sexual? Here's how I see it. Sexiness is right between love and sex, right on the edge of emotion and physicality, if you will. If love is fully dressed and sex is nudity, sexiness would be teasing. It's this playfulness right on the edge that turns us on, when we're not sure which way the situation is gonna go. Drake's buddy Weeknd does much the same, singing religious or highly sexual texts in an almost angelical voice. But there's more. Listen to this. I did everything to her. She forgave me for everything. This a forever thing. Hate that I treat it like it's a whatever thing. Trust me, girl, this shit is everything. So, what's being teased here? Which part of what you just heard is letting you add 2+2 by yourself? You may have noticed that the sample rate here was downgraded so much that we only hear the lows of the music. Still, in our heads, we hear the full arrangement. We know what this is supposed to sound like because we know what a drum set sounds like in real life. But the music lets us figure that out on our own. Again, it's this tension of holding back or teasing us that makes this sound sexy. In an interview with Q Radio, Dre points out another possible reason for this filtered sound.
As far as the soundscapes go, that's just the music that I choose to make, man. I make my music strictly for the purpose of like driving at nighttime.
If you've ever been to a concert and you didn't bring ear protection, you might be familiar with reversible hearing loss, an adaption mechanism which allows the cochlea, the auditory portion of your inner ear, to protect itself from loud noise. You're still damaging your ears big time, but it does make everything sound a little muffled. So what sound could be more fitting for a relaxing drive home after a crazy night? But wait, there's less. Drake's vocal sound is also cut off. He doesn't have any lows, which leads to an almost radio-like sound. And again, we're left to figure things out on our own. Think of it like this. The music and vocals occupy different halves of the frequency spectrum. Spatially, Drake is almost completely removed from the music. It feels like he's taking a step forward towards you, out of the comfort of the music, which makes him sound almost naked. He sounds more vulnerable, more approachable, more real. But it's not just the production, it's his flow too. You know how originally rap lines were often the length of a bar? like in this example.
Broken glass everywhere, people pissing on the stage, you know they just don't care. I can't take the smell, can't take the noise, got no money to move out, I guess I got no choice. Right.
Drake does that too, but he will often use a technique I call the Ouroboros melody, where he shifts his lines within the bar. This way, the lines are overlapping into the next bar, which adds a certain kind of tension. First, here's what we expect.
Too many drinks have been given to me. I got some women that's living off me. Paid for their flights and hotels, I'm ashamed. Bet that you know them, I won't say no names.
And here's how Drake actually sings it.
Too many drinks have been given to me. I got some women that's living off me. Paid for their flights and hotels, I'm ashamed. Bet that you know them, I won't say no names.
Here's another example where Drake shifts even further.
No snow ties, the rain slips slide like Trick Daddy and Trina. Ollie North pulling like 10 million a season. Queen Street visions that nobody believed in. If we not on the charts, my XO niggas eating.
What effect does this have on you? It loosens up the measures, right? It feels like he's floating on top of the music, like he's having a conversation with the listener, independent from the beat. So again, there's a clear disconnect from the music. Rappers in general often don't lock in with the music as much as singers do. They kind of do their own thing and take control of where the beat goes. To someone who doesn't listen to a lot of hip hop, this can sound confusing because the downbeats aren't as clear as they are in dance music. In hip hop, there's almost a competition of who can mess with the music's flow the most. Rappers are usually not involved with the production of their music, and so if you're able to take a beat and completely make it your own through your flow, that's the highest form of self-expression there is in this genre. One thing Drake loves to do is to skip downbeats. In other words, he doesn't start his lines on the one, but shortly after, as in these examples.
Yeah, coming off the last record, I'm getting 20 million off the record just to off these records, nigga, that's a record. I'm living like I'm out here on my last adventure, past or present when you have to. I couldn't get a bill paid, you couldn't buy the real thing. I was staying up at your place, trying to figure out the whole thing.
I don't know about you, but for me, this also has a calming effect. Drake takes his time, he lets the silence speak. He will also often contrast this with lines that do hit the downbeat, which adds some unpredictability to his flow.
Money just changed everything. I wonder how life without it would go. From the concrete, who knew that a flower would grow? Looking down from the top and it's crowded below. My 15 minutes started an hour ago. Truth over fame, you know I respect the blatant shit. When I hear him talking, I just don't know what to make of it.
This brings me to my next key point, unpredictability. Listen to this.
Worst. Motherfucker never loved her. Fucker never loved her. You ain't know now, you know now. Still had to scrub J's with a toothbrush. Shit. Niggas still playing my old shit. But your shit is like the police asking us questions. Nigga, we don't know shit.
As the title suggests, Drake really goes against all conventions in terms of flow here. He leaves a lot of space between his lines, and some of those lines are just one syllable or three consecutive 16th notes, which is very rare in pop music. All of this makes Drake completely unpredictable, and we're on the edge of our seats trying to move along. And as if Drake's flow and Worst Behavior wasn't unpredictable enough for you already, the production makes it even worse. Listen to Drake's breathing right before he starts singing.
Flex. Nigga, I'm just flex. Nigga never loved us. Do a little like we stress.
There is none. Drake's raps are literally breathless. And it makes him even more unpredictable. Usually, when we hear a breath, that signals to us that someone's gonna speak. When we take those breaths away, we take away all that certainty. When a line hits, it cuts like a knife. And speaking of which, Drake also likes to cut some of his lines, or even words, short. So you think you're gonna hear a simple repetition of what you already heard, but it's not coming. It's not just Drake who does this, though. A lot of his music uses chopped up samples and glitchy drums to play with your expectations. And ultimately, this is where most of the aggression in Drake's more confident songs comes from.
Started from the bottom, now we here. Started from the bottom, now my whole team here. Nigga, started from the bottom, now we here. Started from the bottom, now the whole team fucking here. I didn't keep it real.
Drake is also famous for popularizing another implied tension technique known as hashtag rapping. In it, a line is ended by a comparison, but without the word like or as, just like a hashtag in a Twitter post. Listen to this.
In your city, faded off the brown. Nino, she insists she got more class. We know. Swimming in the money, come and find me. Nemo, if I was at the club, you know I balled. Chemo.
Yet again, this is characterized by something being omitted. We notice that we're not hearing a grammatically correct sentence, and in our minds, we add the word like. This is textbook 2 plus 2. Really quickly, let's talk about melody. Because more often than not, Drake does use specific pitches when rapping, and most of the time, for similar reasons as The Weeknd, that's the 4 and 5.
Get these niggas the look, the verse, and even the hook. I really can't complain, everything is kosher. Why do niggas that are not involved love to get involved? October firm in the cut. Stay at the top like I'm stuck. It's just how I'm giving it up. I ain't even one dance. Got a Hennessy in my hand. When I see potential, I just gotta see it through. All my exes live in Texas like I'm George Strait. Dress hanging off your shoulder, barely sober. I got my eyes on you. I got enemies, got a lot of enemies. I waited 4 days, nigga, where y'all at?
There's also a bunch of songs in which Drake hits some more challenging notes, like a major 7 or a flat 6.
Me like, where you at? I gave you the keys, told you bring it right back. Someone put an order in for a chicken. Told my girl to order in, I need the kitchen.
When it comes to sung melodies, Drake prefers descending melodies that start on the 5 and move towards the flat 3. This gives him the 5 and 4, plus the added sadness of a descending line and the minor 3rd. Unlike The Weeknd, though, he also uses the flat 6 as a neighbor note every now and then, which is unusual. Check it out.
I done did everything to her. She forgave me for everything. Got a reputation for yourself now. Everybody knows and I feel left out. Ever since you met me, like when Chrysler made that one car that looked just like the Bentley. I don't know how to ask you if you're okay. My friends always feel the need to tell me things.
Let's look at some other techniques Drake uses to pull us into his world. One way he does this is by giving his fans their own language in which they can speak. To understand all of Drake's lyrics, you have to do some digging. This creates an inner circle for his fans, almost like in a religion. For example, in his songs, Drake often refers to his record label and now clothing line, OVO. OVO stands for October's Very Own. Why October? Simply because Drake and his early crew were all born in October. Like me. Oh, you want to send me a birthday gift because of your favorite YouTuber? Stop it. Well, I don't know if I should give up my address. If you're a Drake fan, you probably already knew what OVO stands for, and possibly even what the extension XO means. This just goes to show how effective a tool language can be to draw someone in, to give them a bit of mystery to talk about. Or take The 6. This is what Drake calls his hometown Toronto, because there's a 6 in the area codes? Really? So all this time it could have been the 4-2? Well, it doesn't really have to make sense, which brings us back to religion. Here's Drake's logo. If you add 2 plus 2 together, what does it mean? Did you get it? It reads God of Toronto. In a way, Drake positions himself as the leader of an inner circle of fans, what you might call a church. This comes complete with instructions on what music to listen to, what to wear, how to identify yourself, what language to use, and ultimately, through the lyrics, how to live your life. I'm not singling out Drake as the only one who does this, by the way. In fact, most pop artists do something very similar. And this is probably the smartest marketing you can do. You're not just selling music, not just a lifestyle. You're selling a place to call home, a subculture to belong to. As an artist, it is your responsibility to help create the subculture because it is the only way your music can start to get a life of its own, to inspire and influence. Artists today don't write songs that go down in history. The industry is too short-lived for that. They start lifestyles, fashion styles, entire music styles that go down in history. And if all of that seems a little too much to swallow right now, just do what you can manage. That's all you can do anyways. If you're lucky, those few things have an impact and develop a life of their own. At this point, all you have to do is gently steer it in the right direction. This is a movement, not a one-man operation. You will have help if you approach it like a subculture. Why do I believe that? Because I'm in this position right now. I started Holistic Songwriting all by myself in 2015, and a couple of months ago, I got an email from Audi Award-winning director Linnea, who read the addiction formula, if I ever thought about producing an audiobook version of it. And so we got together, I went over the whole thing again, added new techniques, wrote a bonus chapter, and since it's audio and I wanted to do something special for you guys, produced audio examples of some of the techniques and principles in the book to help you learn these concepts even quicker. So if you're like me and you prefer listening to books while driving or working out, the audiobook just released on Audible and you can get it by clicking on the little I up here. If you like this video, I know you're gonna love the addiction formula as well. Anyways, the point is once you get something that works, your movement will grow by itself. Opportunities will present themselves. If your vision is clear, people will want to help you, whether that's by sharing your videos, subscribing to your channel, or producing an audiobook with you. And yes, the beginning is tough. You need to figure out what you want to do. But it's also where you can make the biggest difference. If you enjoyed this video and would like to see more like it, please like, share, subscribe, and look forward to the future because this channel has almost reached its 100,000 subscriber milestone, and I just might have something planned for that. This is Friedemann Findeisen from Holistic Songwriting, and thanks for watching.